Thank you very much for your invitation and yes, you and for the introduction. So I would like to talk to you about our work on electrolysis and its impacts on the power systems. So I'm going to present you a study published in January 2020 on the challenges of developing electrolysis in France by 2035. This study is part of three in-depth studies on the new uses of electricity, electric mobility, hydrogen production by electrolysis, and heating in the building sector in collaboration with ADEME. These three studies are based on the same detailed model of the European power systems. So we use Antares, like Yacine's work. And in the three studies, we focus on impacts on power systems and with associated power mix wanted by the French government. We called it the PPE, the French Energy Plan. Finally, this work is linked with the work and the consultation work on the long term scenario for 2050. And also the work is also the work also participated to the deployment hydrogen plan from published by the government in June 2018, and the work is also consistent with the national France hydrogen strategy published more recently. First of all, one of the first elements highlighted in the study is the confusion that sometimes exists between two reasons to develop hydrogen in the long term. Indeed, hydrogen is often presented both as a factor to reducing CO2 emissions. This is the reason one. And as a source of flexibility for the power system. This is the reason two. However, it's very important to distinguish these two reasons in the analysis. Today, in the French, in the power systems, we have a lot of I will first talk about the reason one. Today, the priorities is to convert the current industrial production of hydrogen by today produced by a steam reforming with natural gas. And so the priority is really to decarbonize this industrial consumption, and also to decarbonize, for example, EV mobility. This is really the priority identified by the public authorities. There is also a possibility to decarbonize the gas consumption by injecting a little hydrogen in the network, in the natural gas network. Okay. So the study here really focuses on this first reason. And the second reason is to consider hydrogen like a storage and destorage solution. We call it power to gas to power, for example. And we heard sometimes that this power to gas to power solution is necessary to balance the systems. However, we have shown that by 2045, the power system should still have access to a large number of flexibilities in France with dispatchable production, demand size management, spillage activation, and at the same time in the neighboring countries by dispatchable group. There is at this horizon still a lot of dispatchable units in Europe. So the use of hydrogen as a storage for power system is therefore for us not necessary in 2045 to accommodate the volume of renewable energy. Moreover, we can say that the efficiency of this storage solution is very low and high cost at this horizon. So this second reason is not analyzed in the report. But this solution is of interest in the long-term work, especially with 100% renewable mixed, and it will be studied later. So, in order, in order to test the technical operation. So on the technical side, the study shows that in energy first, the French energy plan forecast a decarbonized nuclear and renewable production of 615 terawatt-hour by 2045. You can see that on the top right graph. So this energy is more than enough to produce the volume of hydrogen wanted by the French government. In fact, this represents only 5% of the total demand and of the total production at this horizon. Now in power, the electrolysis will not pose any problem of security of supply, for example, because electrolyzers are by nature very flexible and are able to shut down very quickly. For example, during consumption peaks. So it's really a very flexible consumption, and we can easily move it from a moment to another. Okay. There is no concern of power for security of supply. Beyond this aspect, we looked at the finer flexibility that electrolyzer can bring to the system. For example, for reserves or for the networks. And an important result of the study is that the gains associated with the services provided by the electrolyzers that you can see in red on the bottom graph. Should be limited to compare to the cost of the electrolyzers. You can see the cost of electrolyzers in blue and purple on the graph. And in order to test the technical condition of electrolyzers in real conditions, RTE participates to a demonstrator project called Jupiter 1000. In the RTE report, three operating modes deliberately very different and marked and are studied and are studied separately. Because indeed, when we look at the electrolysis project in the reality today, three main families of behavior emerge. So the first mode is the mode one, called when renewables or nuclear are marginal. This is an approach on electricity market only during there is excess of renewable or nuclear margin. And it's a mode that benefits from really decarbonized energy and access low price, but it's characterized by a very low operating time and random production. And this random production required a lot of storage. So this mode really it's really a question to industrial credibility, because if we want in 2035, we want to ensure the continuity of hydrogen supply to industrial user, it will be very very complicated. The second mode, this is the base load mode, except peak periods. The electrolyzers works almost all the time, except during peaks. And this mode could have long operation times, but at potential impact on CO2 emissions. And the price of electricity could be also very sensitive and high. And finally, the third mode is coupling with self-generation. So in general, it's with solar photovoltaic farm, but it could also be with wind farm. So in this mode, the electrolyzers remain connected to the network, and so the cost of electricity for the electrolyzers is very limited because the electricity is direct on the site, but the sites could be very isolated the study has shown that these three different modes leads to very different impact on the power systems. On the environmental aspect, we can say that in France, there is a clear reduction in CO2 emissions. Indeed, the electricity produced in France is largely decarbonized, and it will be even more decarbonized in the coming years with the announced closure of the last coal-fired power plants. So this configuration is very favorable to switch from steam reforming to electrolysis. And in all scenario, we can see that we avoid the emission produced by steam reforming in France if we do electrolysis, and we have a very low impact on emission on the power systems. So the result is that in France we have always 5 to 6 million tons CO2 reduction of emission per year. However, if the analysis is done at the European level, so we can say that the result is more nuanced. Because it's important to understand that an additional load in France leads to a reduction of exports and of export of decarbonized energy to other countries. And however, as illustrated in the graph here, the use of 1 kilowatt hour of decarbonized energy to avoid the use of carbon or coal fire plant, for example, avoid 750 gram CO2. So this is very more efficient to avoid these coal fire plants operating than to replace steam methane reforming by electrolysis. So in order to avoid a negative result in terms of CO2 at the European level, it's necessary to create additional decarbonized energy in France in order not to unbalance the system, and finally to reach a certain neutrality in the exchange and maintain the same level of decarbonized exchange with other countries. And fortunately, this is what the French public authorities have planned in the French multi-annual plan. So the result is with this approach is positive in terms of CO2 in France and in Europe. On the economic side, the comparison of electrolysis with steam reforming is very dependent on the value of the CO2 environmental externality. So the complete cost of electrolysis varies in 2035 from 3 euro per kilogram hydrogen to 6.7 euro per kilogram hydrogen. And this cost integrates H2 hydrogen storage in green, the investment in electrolyzers in yellow, and this is very important in the mode one. And the cost of electricity, and also the cost of adapting the carbon-free generation mix, and this cost is near to 2 euro per kilo hydrogen. So we can see that with all this element, the cost of electrolysis is therefore much higher than the cost of steam reforming, which is 1.8 euro per kilo hydrogen. But on the other end, if we take in account the shadow price of carbon, so the French shadow price of carbon, which is 375 euro per ton in 2035. In this case, the cost of steam reforming will reach near 5 euro per kilo hydrogen. And in this case, electrolysis appears to be less costly. So the result, yes?
It's time to wrap up. The time is out. So could you?
Okay. So it's the last slide. So the result shows that this is relevant from an socio-economic point of view to replace in the 15 coming years electrolysis to replace steam reforming by electrolysis. And yes, we will have further work on the this was for 2035, but for the 2050 horizon, there will be further work. Yes, it's okay. It's to conclude the result for the long-term horizon will be presented in a final report published in September, I think. And this is the last slide for me.
Thank you very much, Mathilde.